Chief, we had set this up quite some time ago, and you disappeared. There you are. And you were going to give us a little bit of a wrap-up of policing in Sarasota for the year 2020. Can you address that at least briefly, just to tell us, you know, what you've faced and what's been going on?
Sure. 2020 was one of those unprecedented years. And by the way, Happy New Year to everybody. I hope you had a great holiday. It's great to see all of you. I can't wait until this vaccine becomes more widespread and everybody is able to get back together and see each other in person. I really miss that. That's the best part of my job. So Happy New Year to all of you. 2020 was unprecedented. It was one of those years that started off with very high expectations of initiatives that we wanted to put in place, training for our officers, a lot of goals that we had started off the year with, and it quickly turned to COVID-19, had to strategically deal with a workforce that potentially could lose up to 60 to 80% of its personnel at any given time due to the pandemic. Luckily, we never reached those levels because we put things in place right away to prevent that. Dealing with issues within the city that dealt with COVID, to wear a mask, not wear a mask. Things were constantly changing to an event that happened over Memorial Day weekend, 1,600 miles away from us with the death of George Floyd, which impacted law enforcement across the country, across actually the world, and dealing with issues related to that. 22 protests that were all luckily peaceful, didn't result in any arrests or any crimes taking place at all. The end of the year, which the month of December, I was really happy that we were going to be gliding through the rest of 2020, only to find that the city manager was leaving and Marlon Brown was going to be the interim city manager, and he was asking and taking my deputy chief to be the interim deputy city manager, which threw our agency into what they call in like Top Gun, a little bit of a tailspin, but luckily we've got good people within our organization and we're able to right the ship really well and move forward. And that was our 2020. The good news about 2020 was the crime rate. We were able to reduce violent crime, the UCR numbers, as you know, Uniform Crime Report, we were able to reduce that crime by almost 10% this year, 9.7%. We still have a few outstanding reports to see if that's going to impact it, but at this point right now, 9.7% reduction. And I'm really proud to share with you, since I started as chief, we've been able to reduce UCR crime by over 50% in the last 8 years. And I'm really proud of the men and women of the Sarasota Police Department. I'm proud of the partnership within the community and within the city that all worked together to do that, which ultimately led to the city of Sarasota being named the number one best city to retire in the country, which is, I think, significant. Our 2021 goals are threefold. We're going to standardize our operations so that all of us are doing the same thing the same way. We're going to be planning a lot. We can anticipate things, plan for the worst, hope for the best, and then using technology to help us be more efficient and effective. This year, my motto, and if you ever visit the police station once things open up, is going to be pay attention. There'll be signs all around. Pay attention to what's going on internally with our own customers, our own staff, and pay attention externally. I want our officers to catch the traffic accident that destroyed some poles before Jim Lample sends me a picture in the morning saying, hey, this happened on Main Street. Did you guys see this? I want my officers to catch that before the community does. So I'm asking them to pay attention. And so that's our motto for the year. And we're also pushing out officer wellness and safety. Valentine's Day, there's going to be three areas that we're going to be targeting: physical health, mental health, and financial health for police officers. And we've got a number of things from peer counseling that we're going to be opening up to actually having a psychiatrist on staff that we're going to make it. What I want to do is have our officers, besides having a physical every year, which is good, to have a mental evaluation every year where they go to a doc. It doesn't get reported to us. They just go to get a health, kind of a health checkup and make sure they're okay. And the only way that the doc would report stuff back to us is if they're homicidal or suicidal, which would kind of would be expected to report back to us. But we got a couple of hurdles before we do that. Money is one. getting union buy-in is the other, but I think we'll be able to do something hopefully with officer wellness and safety. And then we're implementing body cameras. And we actually hired an outstanding director for our body cameras program. He actually implemented and developed the program in Las Vegas, which is really an outstanding agency who really meets great standards. So by probably mid-year, before July, we'll have body cams for our officers. We're in the middle of impact bargaining. And then the last thing is I'm in the process of deciding on who the new deputy chief's going to be, and then I'll be able to promote a captain, a lieutenant, and sergeant within the organization. I am going to look internally. I'm not doing a nationwide search like I've done in the past. I think we've developed good people within our own organization. I think the only time you usually bring outside people in is if you feel like there's some problems within the organization. And I'm proud of the captains we have here. And I think one of them will be more than capable of filling the shoes of deputy chief. And then that'll allow me to promote those other positions. And I'll be happy to talk to you more extensively. I know Pat explained to you, I've had this idea for years of having a portal that's a complaint portal where citizens can actually go in. And so can police officers and people that work here in the city can go into the portal and say, I saw, like Jim would send us an email, I saw damage to this property. And then it gets sent into the portal. It immediately goes to the appropriate person, whether it's public works or the police department. And then we get assigned that responsibility. And then we do something about it. And then we respond back that it's been completed on the date and time. And then Jim or whatever citizen that brought it to our attention would then get notification. So there's a clear letting people know that something was done, that we took your complaint seriously. We jumped on it and it was completed on this date. I've been trying to push that for years and it looks like it's we've got some movement on that. So I'm excited about that. And I'm willing to take any questions you have.
Thank you. Does anybody have any questions?
Yeah, I have a question.
Please, Clark.
Chief, what sort of, you said that you had hired or are using some sort of director for the body cams. What sort of issues are involved with using the body cams?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. Because we have, well, we're going to start out with a little over 100 body cams. That's a lot of equipment in order to maintain. And there are a number of things that go into the body cam program, training, maintenance, making sure that the body cams are downloaded, public records requests. There's a whole caveat of things. And instead of talking about that now, what I would ask you to do is if you could be patient, because we're still working on the policy and impact bargaining and in other things, we're actually going to do a presentation on the April meeting of the Independent Police Advisory Panel. We're going to do a whole review of the entire program. We'll introduce the new program director for the police department and they'll tell you what their job specifically is. And instead of talking a lot about it now, because it's very preliminary, we just got the cameras, we're working on the policy and all these other things. If you could go to the meeting or watch it in April, we'll answer all your questions.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions from board members? I want to ask you about the homeless initiative that you talked about very briefly before. It was, can you describe it? And this is the most recent one where you were taking, you were working with First Step.
Yes, what we have right now is First Step is partnering with law enforcement. They actually have an individual that if we have individuals in the city, which we do, they've identified 10 that are repeatedly utilizing police resources and also coastal resources, and that those individuals are now going to be worked. People from coastal are actually going to be working with them. They're going to be case managers, and they're going to be helping to get those individuals the help that they need. When I first started working with First Step and Coastal, which is now they're combined, my plan, my initiative, my thought was, is if we could actually have a crisis response team, be able to come out onto the streets and when officers are dealing with people with mental health issues, that would be able to alleviate some of the need for police officers to engage with Baker Acts, Marchman Acts, other mental health issues. And you'd have an expert that could actually deal with the issue that's going on and help that person get the resources. So what ended up happening, because funding is a big issue with this, is they ended up having this preliminary where they identify in the county and the city individuals that are in need of mental health services and that are high users of those services, and that they could take them kind of like low lying fruit, get them into the help, and that would reduce the calls for service to their locations, and then expand the program from there. And once we have a few months of success, then maybe look at expanding it to the program I was telling you about, Eileen, which would be actually have people respond to the scene and help people get into the resources they need.
That sounds very promising, actually.
And it's exciting. It really is. It's very exciting.
At some point, would you come back and tell us how that is proceeding, if you don't mind?
I would love to.
Other questions? Let me open it up to the guests. Do any of the guests have questions of the police chief? Well, I do have one. Are your police officers all vaccinated? At what point do they receive the vaccine?
Yeah, that's a good question. The governor's priorities, and I don't disagree with him, are to help people that are older, people at assisted living facilities, people that are more vulnerable, 65 and older, to allow them to get the vaccines first, healthcare workers also. And they have given some out to the firefighter paramedics, and the police are somewhere a little bit lower on the list. And so we haven't gotten any indication. We have our officers prepared to get them when they are available. We're making it voluntary because we do the same thing for the hepatitis vaccine. Is if you want to take it, and you have to sign a waiver if you don't want to take it. I don't know why anybody wouldn't want to take it, but there are some people that don't take the flu shot. I get the flu shot every year. It's all personal. I think it's important to get the vaccine. I'll tell you, my daughter just recently got the vaccine. I'm very grateful. She's a police officer up north, and she got the Pfizer vaccine. And she said the only thing she had was some pain in her arm, which is, I get that same thing when I get a flu shot. So there's some other people I know that got it. They felt a little bit of the effects, like you would getting a cold, you know, a little bit of chills, maybe a little bit of headache, but not for long, very minor, and Tylenol and ibuprofen seemed to work for them. So I think the getting it is the right thing to do, and I encourage people to get it. I don't know when we're in line to get it, but as soon as we do, we'll get our officers over there to get it.
Great. Now,